Okay, brothers and sisters, I'm back. I got lots of topics, as I said. Which way to go? I guess I should continue to talk about the United States. You know, we talk about the great sale on the back of the dollar bill. I've made videos way back, and some of you have seen it, some of you are not. So I guess I need to do a review of that. I'd made a video the Lord had just shown me. I had a night vision the other day of the all-seeing eye from the back of the dollar bill, and then a few days ago, I made this video about the Illuminati or whatever it was, the Rise of the New World Order, Part 1. And, you know, so there's different tracks to follow. You know, the bloodlines of the Antichrist is what I call it. So, you know, I'm just going to try to do a review. Now, you know, so that's why I figure out what path. You know, I could do a review and talk about the Pope and, you know, religious Babylon and all this kind of stuff. Or we could look at the political side of it. So, let's talk about the duality of the United States. Now, it is true. There's a brother who's a normal watcher of my videos. He had commented just on the video I just made about the all-seeing eye vision that I had, saying that the founding fathers were really Christians and the history was changed to call them deist. You know, there's probably some truth in that, brothers and sisters, but it's also true. That's why I'm talking about the duality of the United States. The United States became a Christian nation because of the pilgrims, you know, the Puritans, and then the original people, like I've said in a video way back, my ancestors were at Jamestown. And they came because they were religiously persecuted. They were Anabaptist, you know, which is the forerunner of modern-day Baptist. They were persecuted over there in England, and then they came to the New World for religious freedom. Lots of people did, you know, the Europeans from England and Germany and these other places. They escaped, you know, to the New World for religious freedom. That's the original people. You know, I even thought about making a video about that. I keep forgetting to mention it, how, you know, the East Coast, particularly the Bible Belt, is a Bible Belt because that's where all these Christians who were persecuted came to. And when they were settling out west, I guess it's a whole other video, but why did people go to California? For gold, for the gold rush, see? So, I mean, you want to look at the root of these different areas. I mean, look at the root of the love of money. And people going out to San Francisco for the gold rush, and look what happened. Of course, that's the hotbed of homosexuality and sodomy and all things New Age in the United States, Bohemian Grove. When I mention something you don't know what it is, use the Google, as President Bush would say. Use the Google and look it up. And go look it up when I mention these things, because I want to go through it fast without it, because I would love to stop and explain all these things, but I can't in one video, brothers and sisters. Even though I've made videos about it in the past. So right out there near San Francisco is Bohemian Grove. Satanic, sodomy. And that's why I want to talk about the duality of the United States. Now that I mentioned that, let me pick up on that. And I've already just made some points, food for thought. So the original pilgrims and all that, they came for religious freedom. But then the founding fathers, all but two of the signers of the Declaration of Independence, were Masons. Okay, and Thomas Jefferson was a deist. Thomas Jefferson remade his own Bible, and it's up there in the museum at his house, or it's in Washington D.C. I can't remember, and I've seen it before. Maybe it's in the Masonic temple there in Washington D.C. I can't remember, but Thomas Jefferson made his own Bible, and what he did is he went through the Bible and cut out everything that he did the New Testament. He took out all the parts where Jesus did miracles. He took out all the parts where Jesus would say he was the Son of God or anything like that, and made it, a Gnostic Bible. You know, just the good sayings, and Jesus was a wise man, and all this kind of stuff. So he downplayed or was against, you know, Jesus being the Savior and the Son of God and all these things, in his own personal belief. Lots of other things. As someone mentioned in the comments, back before I became a pastor, back when I was a backslider, and I was a Mason. I used to be a Mason, and I used to study history. I used to read history stuff all the time. Revolutionary War all the way through the Civil War. I used to read all kinds of books. And I had read the book of Sally Hemings, the story of Sally Hemings, which was the concubine of Thomas Jefferson. He had all these illegitimate children with a woman who he held as a slave. You know, so all of the, I think the whole thing you can say is all politicians, almost 100% of politicians, live this duality. You know, they have that public. So Like when that Christian historian guy, this Barton, who gets up there and quotes all these Christian sayings of Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin and all these guys, that was their political stump speeches to get the Christians to vote for them. Just like President Bush, the last president, he was supposed to be anti-abortion and all that, but I remember when he was president that, and they had the Congress and the Senate. Did they do anything to overturn abortion? No. When they had the Right to Life rally in Washington, D.C., I watched it myself. I had already become a pastor. I had voted for President Bush. When they had the Right to Life rally in Washington, D.C., President Bush spoke by phone over a speaker over the phone to that group. He did not appear in person to the Right to Life rally in Washington, D.C. He could have made it a national issue. They had the House and the Senate. His dad, Reagan and Bush Sr., they, like the vast majority of the Supreme Court justices were put in by those guys and President Bush. And as a matter of fact, the ones that this President Bush put in, the last President Bush, matter of fact, the head guy, he's the one that flip-flopped and supported Obamacare. I'm sure they were blackmailing him. That's what they do to all these politicians. They're blackmailed because he has a secret life, San Francisco lifestyle, secret San Francisco lifestyle. Lots of them do. If you had researched, that's how the man, the Illuminati, controls these politicians, through their personal vices. Like President Clinton, he was a big womanizer. They controlled him through that. They could have exposed and ruined President Clinton before he ever got elected. He would have never got elected. They cover up for all these guys because they're willing to do the will of the Illuminati, of Lucifer. They can't get elected. As they say, it appears to be true that President Nixon, President Kennedy was the last, independent president who tried to do his own thing, even though he wasn't a Christian. He was a womanizer and all that stuff. They thought they could control him through that. But they couldn't, so they had to deal with him and take him out. That's a message to all presidents. President Reagan, if you go listen to the speeches of Reagan in the 50s and 60s, all these great things he said, But who did he pick as his vice presidential candidate? One of the biggest Council on Foreign Relations boys, New World Order boy who made all kinds of comments about the 1,000 points of light. Go look up where that comes from. That comes from a big old mansion that is where they, of witches, in there, and I think it's in Belgium or Holland along in there, where they have a room where they do this child sacrifices or whatever. There in the name of that room, the ceiling, they call it the 1,000 points of light. President Bush talked about that in some of his speeches. He talked about the New World Order. Bush Sr., he's one of the, right in there with the big boys. Right in there with the big boys. So, the duality of the United States, as I mentioned, a lot of Christians are under the false precepts that the Republicans are Christian. There are a few that are Christian. But as an example, I want to give you some facts, and stop being in denial of what's really going on here. It's just like worldwide wrestling, It's all fake. 99% of what these politicians do is smoke and mirrors, and that's how Satan operates, in smoke and mirrors. As an example, you can go see a picture, President Bush kissing this bald-headed guy on top of the head. The guy's name, I think, is David Gannon. Now, this guy is a homosexual porn star. Homosexual porn star who spent like over 150 nights in the White House. Here's President Bush, supposed to be a big Christian. He's got a homosexual porn star spending 150 nights in the White House. Here's Bush himself. You can see the pictures. In the where they have the conferences, the conference room where they have the press conferences in the White House. Here's President Bush kissing a guy on top of the head. You can see it on the internet. So, Bush went out to Bohemian Grove. Now, Bohemian Grove, as I mentioned, President Nixon, when his tapes had been released, I've talked about all this stuff before. I'm doing it for the benefit of people who didn't see it. President Nixon, his tapes have been released now after so many years. They start releasing the tapes, and he mentioned about Bohemian Grove, and he said that Bohemian Grove was a bunch of, he used the word faggots, and he used a lot worse language than that, but he said that's why he didn't like to go out there, because when he was vice president, he went with President Eisenhower, loved to go to Bohemian Grove. So President Nixon went as when he was the vice president in the 1950s. And like I say, the duality of the United States, brothers and sisters, the duality of our government, we see that we have all this Christian founding, but yet, these Masons, If you go to Washington, D.C., as I mentioned before, used to go in there without a pass into the Capitol building. I went in there before the Capitol building, before, I guess it was 9/11, they changed it where you have to get some kind of a ticket to go in there. I walked all over that place before. It's really just through a metal detector. But when you go into that rotunda and look up into that rotunda, it's called the Apothecary of President Washington, inside that rotunda, painted by a Mason. You got the Mayan calendar up there on the side, and then at the top, you've got George Washington sitting there wearing a toga. Now, there's a big statue of George Washington in D.C., same as this painting, basically. There's President Washington wearing a Greek toga, and he's doing the as above, so below Baphomet symbol. And then there's all these Greek gods, all the mythology gods, Apollo, Poseidon, whoever. And the Apothecary of Washington is the apotheosis of Washington. He becomes a god. It means to become a god. So George Washington became a god. He's up there with the gods. You're talking about the Greek and Roman and all that gods, not the God of the Bible. They got him right up in there. On top of the Capitol Dome is a god that is actually Isis, but it's another name. It's another god, but it's also in Egyptian, it's Isis. I'm trying to think now because I've been looking at so much different stuff. It's been a while since I looked at that. On top of the Capitol Dome is a female goddess, as I said, but I think it's the Greek version. So anyway, it's a Greek goddess. It's not from the Bible. Some people try to say it's some kind of a Native American. No, it's a Greek goddess that's on top of the Capitol Dome. Now, across from the Capitol Dome, brothers and sisters, across the mall is the George Washington Monument, which is an ancient phallic symbol. Now, if you look at that thing from above, around that thing is two circles that cross over. Now, I'm trying to remember what they call it. They call it the something Pisces. But anyway, it represents the female on the ground. These lines represent the female. And then the George Washington Monument, of course, is the male. And then the dome represents the pregnant. This is what this stuff means, brothers and sisters. You can go look it up. The dome of the Capitol building represents the impregnated womb of the human woman. The George Washington Monument represents the phallus of Horus from ancient Egypt. And of course, the god up there, the Egyptian name for that god is Isis. So Isis represents really the human woman, and then Horus is the god, the fallen angel, having sex with the daughters of men, producing the Nephilim. So starting with President Reagan in the 1980s, only since the 1980s, every president now takes their oath between the dome, in front of that dome, and then here's the phallic symbol across, and then right in front of it, brothers and sisters, you have to open your eyes. You like that movie, Eyes Wide Shut. Open your eyes and see what the devil's doing right in front of people. That reflecting pool right there is reflecting the Washington Monument. As above, so below. There it is. The reflection of the giant phallic symbol, showing that as above, so below. Just like the square and compass of masonry. As above, so below. Same thing. So who is, what is the offspring, of Isis representing the earth, the woman, the human woman, and then the fallen angel is, Horus. And what do? They're producing a son, which is symbolic of the Antichrist, okay, which is Apollo in Greek, Apollyon from the book of Revelation. We see the name of the beast who kills the two witnesses. It's the beast from the bottomless pit. What's his name? Apollyon. In ancient Greek writings, Apollo and Apollyon are used interchangeably. In Hebrew, it's Abaddon. So who is the offspring? It's the president. Every time a president gets inaugurated in the Masonic temple up the street, they have a ceremony to raise, to resurrect. Because that's the whole story of this Horus. You know, Osiris is the dad and Horus is the son. You know, Horus is Apollo and Osiris is the dad. He was chopped up into 13 pieces, like our 13 colonies. His wife put his body back together, but she couldn't find his phallus, so she made a golden phallus. She had some relations with this thing and then produced a son. Okay, so in order to do that, he had to be resurrected. You know, like the Antichrist will appear dead and he'll come back from the dead. Jesus was resurrected. So that's part of the story, this resurrection story. So every year, or every time the president is inaugurated in the Masonic temple, they're having an ancient Egyptian ceremony of resurrecting Horus. So that I've got to tell a whole lot more. Let me tell some more about this. In ancient Egypt, when they had a pharaoh, every year the pharaoh would go to the temple and they would have this thing where he would become a god, because the, you know, the pharaoh was known as, you know, Ra's son, God on earth. Okay, so every year they would go into the temple and they have this ceremony when he would really become possessed, you know, by Horus or the son, whatever. Getting those, I always get those two names mixed up, the father and son of Horus. And see, I've got all these different names. The all-seeing eye picture. And so he would become possessed by that. And that's the same ceremony they're doing for the President of the United States. So you become possessed by Horus, which ends up being, in the Romans, it's, you know, or Greek, it's Apollo. Same spirit that they're trying to put on our president. So there's so much information I get with. So that's the duality of the United States. So when we look at the back of our money, I've discussed this before, the Lord has led me independently and supernaturally through words and visions and dreams to study this. And then when I studied it, there's other people that had done it a different way. You know, they had researched it through history and documents, and then they made videos about it. You know, people who write books and stuff, like Dr. Tom Horn, as an example. Anyway, so there's this guy, Doc Marquis, a different guy. The Lord had given me his name and said, the video, because I'd seen videos, but I didn't watch it. I saw the thumbnail of a video he had done about the back of the dollar bill, and I didn't pay any attention to it. I was just flipping through it. The next day, the Lord spoke to me and said, that video is right. The information in that video is right. Go watch that video by Doc Marquis. The Lord even said it spoke his name. I went back and watched that video about the back of the dollar bill. And the thing about it is, which he didn't talk about all of these things, Dr. Tom Horn has also showed some of these things. But on the back of that dollar bill, it says, you know, announcing the arrival of the New World Order, you know, in Latin. That phrase comes from something called the Cumae Sibyl, which is like the Oracle of Delphi. You've probably heard of the Oracle of Delphi. This is another oracle like the one at Delphi. This is the Cumae Sibyl. And this was women who became possessed by that python spirit, the snake spirit of Apollo. And this was a poem or a prophecy written about the return of Apollo to bring in a golden age on earth. That quote is exactly from that poem. On the back of our money. Don't tell me we come from a Christian nation, because our leaders are from the devil. Jesus said Satan is, you know, the god of this world, the god of this age. Satan is the god of this age. He even, when Jesus was tempted by Satan, Satan said, oh, if you'll bow down and worship me, you know, he showed Jesus all the kingdoms in a moment and said, you know, the authority's been given to me over these kingdoms. I'll give them to you if you'll bow down and worship me. Jesus did not say, oh, no, Satan, you don't have that authority. My father didn't give you that authority. Jesus never said that. Jesus said, you know, it is written, thou shalt worship God and him only. So that's what Jesus said. But he didn't say to Satan, oh, it's not true, you don't have that authority. Satan does have that authority. It says that several times throughout the Bible. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said, you know, the God of this age is coming and I have no part in him. The Apostle Paul calls Satan the God of this world. So these kingdoms that we have, that's why all these politicians are so evil and wicked, because Satan is the one who's buying their souls. They're selling their souls to Satan to be in power. 90% of these politicians, that's what they do. That's the nature of politics. You know, sex, perversion, drugs, money, all these corruptions, it's just part of the system. Even though we have lots of Christians, I'm talking about the politicians. You can go to Washington, D.C., walk around, look at all the monuments, all this demonic, satanic, and all this, every one of those buildings are made like Greek Go look at the Treasury, Department of Treasury, all those buildings. They're all Greek, like Greek temples and stuff. Nothing to do with Christianity. It's all, you know, demonic and satanic and Greek mythology and all this kind of stuff. Nothing to do with our Lord. Nothing to do to represent. If I went to Washington, D.C. and saw the monument and the Capitol and all those things and knew something about it, I would never say, oh, this is a Christian nation. Look at the giant statue of Jesus they have. Look at the Bible verses they've got written all over the place. No, no, that's not the United States. It's the duality of the United States, brothers and sisters. God has used the Christian people and blessed this country because of the people. But majority of the time, you know, all the politicians are the same old wicked that they always are. As they say, power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And that's what we have, brothers and sisters. I'm trying to think, there's so many different areas I could go into and talk about these things. The back of the dollar bill, as I mentioned, that slogan is from a prophecy from the spirit of the Antichrist, Apollo, Apollyon. Go look in Revelation, you'll see that the beast who kills the two witnesses, the beast, the first beast, is Apollyon. It's Apollo, this destroyer. That's why Paul talks about the son of perdition. The Antichrist is the son of perdition. Perdition, that word there, is Apollonia. Destruction. The word in English, you would say, really, is destruction, the destroyer. That's why Abaddon, Apollyon, means the destroyer. Satan comes not but to kill, steal, and destroy. The Antichrist is the destroyer. So, as I said, and this video is not on that topic, but the Antichrist will either be a fallen angel who appears as a man. In the Bible, angels can appear as men. And people thought they were humans. So Apollyon himself will appear, and then the fallen angel that's behind the false prophet in the Greek is Mercury. If you go study that, you'll find out it's Mercury. But these fallen angels will either possess men or they themselves will appear as men. That's what's going to end up happening, brothers and sisters. So I made many videos about this way back, and then go into the religious side of it. I want to stay with America. But anyway, the Vatican is waiting for disclosure. The Vatican's whole role in this is for disclosure. The Pope will endorse the aliens, but they're really fallen angels. They're looking for these aliens to return, and they want to hear a better gospel from them. The Vatican says that the aliens have not fallen like us, and they probably have a better gospel than we do. And the Pope will endorse them. President Obama and all those guys will endorse them. Now, you probably never heard anything like this if you haven't seen my videos about it. Something that is a game changer. Because you can ask yourself, the false prophet and the Antichrist will have supernatural powers. Today, President Obama, none of those guys that people keep talking about, Prince William or whomever, they have no supernatural powers. They're not calling down fire from heaven and all this kind of stuff. But fallen angels can do that. Now, what would, and people ask this question, why, what would make the Muslims join a one world religion if it's not Islam? What would make Buddhists and nominal Christians, lukewarm Christians, who are, you know, nominal means in name only, people who say they're Christians but they're not, which is probably 90% of the people you'll meet who say they're Christians, 75%. Let's be optimistic and say 50%. 50% of the people that say they're Christian are not. So you got the Buddhists, Hindus, Muslims, all this, whatever. Atheists, whatever. Who's going to make all these people unite? You think even President Clinton, who was very charismatic, you think these people have the charismatic ability? President Obama's already been president 6 years. He can't get anything done. Does he have the personality and the charisma to unite the world into one religion and all this kind of stuff by himself? Not now, unless he became possessed by Apollyon. It's not happening. But if the aliens land, which are really going to be fallen angels in disguise, and say, here we are, we created you, we're from the Sumerian tablets, we came from planet X, Nerubu, and we're here to save you, and you know, we're going to save the planet from global warming, from climate change, and your own destruction of nuclear war. We've come to bring unity and peace among all mankind and give you the true, we took a monkey and put our DNA in it and created you to be our servants thousands of years ago. Here we are. You know, that will be a game changer if it goes down like that. That's my personal main theory of what's going to happen. You know, it's going to be something that it's got to be something at that level to get the whole world. The Bible says the whole world will say, will follow the wonder after the beast. And they'll say, who is like the beast? Who can make war against the beast? So, you see, it's somebody that is fierce. It says fierce countenance, all this kind of stuff. Powerful, supernatural power and all this kind of stuff. There's no man on earth today walking around with all this kind of calling down fire from heaven and everyone's afraid of them and everybody's going to follow them in one day and all this. So when people talk, everybody keeps saying Obama, Obama, Obama. Obama is very weak, indecisive, the opposite of the Antichrist. The Antichrist will be decisive. He'll be a man of fierce countenance. People will be afraid of him. He's going to be charismatic. He's going to be all those things. And I don't see that in anybody that people are talking about walking around today on this earth. It's got to be supernatural. Either one of these people that are candidates will become possessed by Apollyon, or Apollyon, as I said, himself will come back. Anyway, brothers and sisters, there's so much more I could go with it. I guess I'll call this part two. You know, I'm talking about the duality of the United States, the bloodlines of the Antichrist. This is my first video. But here I'm just trying to lay out all this information. Let me keep going because I've already been going. I mentioned this before. Henry Wallace, Secretary of Agriculture, he got the Great Seal put on the back of the dollar bill. It had been out of sight. The backside with the pyramid and all that had not really been used for anything, really, for 200 years. You know, and then Henry Wallace brought it back because his guru, this Nicholas Rorick, I mentioned that on the video the other day. You can go look all these things up. Go look up the Lapis Opus or whatever it's called, the Lapis, whatever it is, Excess Lapis, whatever it is, this stone that they try to think is the pillow from Jacob's dream pillow. That's what some people think it might be. But of course, that stone that they inaugurate, that they will inaugurate Prince William on one day, is that what they call that scone, you know, of ruin or whatever it is, the stone of destiny there that was given to Scotland. You know, they just gave it back to Scotland after 800 years or whatever, that all those royals are inaugurated on. They claim that stone is Jacob's pillow and came from, you know, I think they try to say Joseph of Arimathea brought it to England, all these different folklores about it. Who knows? But of course, we as Christians, we know there's no power in these talisman that people try to use. There's no power in those things, in rosary beads, statues of Mary, crucifixes and all that, like you see in the exorcism. And what they do in exorcisms, you know, using that crucifix and the holy water and all that. It's not in the Bible. And the Hail Marys and all that. All these magical things, there's no power in any of those things anyway, brothers and sisters. The power is in the name of Jesus Christ. There's power in his name only. It's a name above every name, the Bible says. That at his name, every knee shall bow, in heaven and on the earth and under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's why the Lord had me make that video the other day. Everybody wants to hear about the date of the rapture, Antichrist, all that stuff. But people need to be rooted and grounded in the Word, brothers and sisters. People need to be rooted and grounded in the Word. They don't want to hear it. But I'm going to, as the Lord is leading me, I'll continue to make videos. The Lord has actually been having me study about Daniel this week, and I've got to try to make me a chart or something of the dates to rebuild the temple and all that, and all these time gaps. And the Lord had actually told me, you know, why don't you count this period of 74 years from 1948 for the rebuilding of the millennial temple. That's 2022 minus 7 years for the tribulation puts you at 2015. I'll give you the short version. So I'm not setting any date, but I mean, that's just something that the Lord led me to look at. I've never seen anybody do that particular calculation. I got that calculation from the gaps back there between the decree to build the temple and when they actually started building it. It's a gap of 74 years. And then, you know, it was 1948, 1967, but I used the 1948 date. Anyway, I'd have to need to make a chart to show all these things. It's just something that the Lord had me looking at. anyway, brothers and sisters, we're very close, and I'm talking about this at the end of this video. Netanyahu's coming to speak. It's going to be a significant day when he speaks. And then the day before Purim, he'll be speaking. And then, of course, his topic will be about Iran, probably Persia. And then, of course, the Pope is coming to speak on one of the blood moons to Congress. These things are becoming very historic. As I made a video a while back, I should just tag this on it. I'm trying to just keep this about the United States, not about religion. But the Pope is going to, you know, come out and say that all Catholics need to honor Mother Earth and all this kind of stuff. You know, this communist, green, one-world government. You know, the religion part of it is Mother Earth, Isis, Gaia, Mother Earth. You know, because the woman, the human woman, is the one who has sex with a fallen angel. So that's why this whole Mother Earth thing is about. Ultimately, Mother Earth is the fallen angels are talking about human women. I mean, that's part of all this. It's pretty weird, but it's true. There you go. That's how they got in trouble. They left their first estate, as it tells us in Jude and in Genesis chapter 6. And that's where the Nephilim came from and all that. So it always goes back to the same thing. It always goes back as it was in the beginning. The Bible tells us that in Ecclesiastes, King Solomon wrote that. You know, as it was in the beginning, so it is in the end. It's always the same. You know, these patterns that God follows and the pattern that the devil follows. It's always the same thing. And what was the first thing that Satan told Eve? You know, God doesn't want you to eat the fruit because you will become like God. You will become a God. So what is the Antichrist going to be telling people? You can become a God. How do you become a God? By receiving the, which I made videos about a long time ago, when you take that mark of the beast, your DNA will be changed. You'll become a Nephilim. You become a Superman. You become a Giborim, like Nimrod became a mighty hunter before the Lord. Just like he was called a Gibor, so were the Nephilim were called Gibors. He became one of them. They were doing some kind of DNA manipulation and all this kind of stuff. That's why God sent the flood. I'm jumping into all this stuff, but I made videos about this before. Some of you never heard anything like this. If you see the whole point of all that God did with the children of Israel and killing the Canaanites and all, you know, killing those Amalekites and all that and told them to wipe out everything of those giants, you will see that God was preserving the bloodline of mankind through Noah down through Israel to bring forth the Messiah, the seed of the woman. It's the whole, if you look at the Bible history through the lens of God protecting the seed of the woman, God protecting the pure DNA of mankind to bring forth the Messiah, then all of it makes sense of what God did of having them kill the tribes there when they went into the promised land, even their animals and their children and everything, kill everything there. Because their bloodline was contaminated with the giants, even like Goliath. Still had giants in the time of King David. These were people that had the blood of fallen angels. Anyway, so if someone today tells you they're a half fallen angel, half man, then that means they're a beast. They're a beast. They're not a human. God created a spirit for a human. He created a spirit for a dog. He created a spirit for a cat. God didn't create a spirit for a cat and a dog mixed together. That's why the DNA mixing that they're doing today in science is the same thing that the fallen angels were doing in the time of Noah, the same reason God sent the flood. Same thing they're doing in science today. All of this DNA blending, trying to be like God, trying to be as a God and create new creatures. What spirit is there in God's creation for something that's half cat, half dog? If someone says they're half fallen angel, half man, God didn't make a spirit for that. That's a Nephilim. Nephilim cannot be born again. Only humans can be born again. God bless you guys. I mean, you know, I could go on and on and on. That's why it's nice to do one video so I can remember what all I put in here. If I do one video, 10 minutes here, 1 minute, 10 minutes there, you know, then you can't follow what I'm saying. It's just so, the rabbit trail is running every direction, brothers and sisters. And that's why, you know, it's kind of boring, you know, to people, I guess, when you bring it back, hey, this is the gospel, you know, there's power in the name of Jesus. This is where we need to be, right with God. You know, they make let their imaginations run wild on all these rabbit trails. I'm laying these out here as the Lord has shown me to be a warning to people. To a warning to people. Stay off of these rabbit trails. This is where it leads to. These rabbit trails lead to destruction. Well, brothers and sisters, we had what they call here a brownout. Now you experience for yourself what it's like to live in the Philippines. You can't see me on here, but you can still record. Now, see, this is what I deal with a daily life of living in the Philippines. Brownouts on and off on a regular basis. Internet is, you talk about slow, probably takes me 3 or 4 hours to load a 20-minute video, brothers and sisters, every time. And that's an hour, you know, that's a good internet connection. So, brothers and sisters, you see the obstacles that I'm against. But, brothers and sisters, I by the grace of God, I will press through and do God's will and go forward. I ask for your prayers, brothers and sisters, that you know, that the electricity won't be keep going out because, you know, there's lots of mosquitoes and it's really hot and humid here without, if you don't have an air conditioner. So thank the Lord I've got a window unit air conditioner, if the power's on. And, you know, Joshua, he died of dengue fever, which is from a mosquito bite. So while we're here with Matthew, of course, I want to keep him in front of a fan or an air conditioner because I don't want him to get bit by the mosquitoes. So I ask you to pray that our power will stay on as much as possible, that we'll be protected from the dengue fever and all these kind of things. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I have lots of videos to make. I know that maybe, you know, it would be more entertaining if I had more graphs and charts and, you know, but the time and effort it would take to make graphs, brothers and sisters, and all this professional presentation, I just don't have the time. I can't do it. I'm sorry, brothers and sisters. But I just want to thank all you guys who watch my videos, and I really appreciate y'all. So God bless. I ask you to pray for us, and I'm praying for all of you guys who asked me to pray for you.